First part of the question is, how is being silent or quiet before the Lord important?
Because we'll be going with our own agenda. We're making all the noise. It is important that we go to hear from him. Important things happen when he speaks, not when I speak. That is the key to it, really. I can pray my socks off, but I'm missing the mark of what he wants me to pray for. But if I will be still and silent long enough about a particular subject or person, he will tell me how he wants me to pray. And that will be a one-liner, and it will just hit the spot. That's it. You just know when you've hit the spot with God. So being a mystic is very much a person of intercession, because they live in the throne room. That is where the business is done. It's not done when they're out there seeing people. It's already been settled in the throne room. So by the time they're out there in converse with the world or the Christian or whoever they're with, what they've agreed with God and heard from him and got their instructions there will work itself out. So they walk with confidence, you see, because they know it's already done.
Because they hear his voice, but his voice is never silence itself?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Yes, sometimes it is just complete. You're married, you sit there with your wife in companionable silence, you're not chatting all the time, you're still with one another, you're at peace with one another. There are long, long periods for a contemplative where you're just sitting enjoying the presence of the Lord. So it's not a continual dialogue. And when he holds out the scepter and invites you to come and touch the scepter and says to you, up to half the kingdom, then you begin to get bold in what you're going to ask. Hey, Brett, you know, if it please the Lord, can I ask for 50 before you bring judgment? And he goes and barters with the Lord. He knew his position before God, and that was born out of intimacy and friendship and knowing God face to face. But even so, he was a little bit nervous if he was on dangerous ground here bartering with the Lord. And the Lord ends up saying, well, if I find 10, I won't do what I plan to do.
So that's where the dialogue and conversation
comes in. That's where the dialogue and conversation comes in. But he chooses the subject. Because God had come down to bring judgment and to tell Abraham what he was about to do. Why did he do that? Because he wanted Abraham to intercede. So he would tell the prophetic person what he's going to do, and the prophet stands before the Lord and then says, is there any way I can change your mind about that, Lord? And then gets the invitation to come forward and touch the scepter and start. Can I ask? Yeah, you can ask for that. Well, that's all right. I'm on a roll here. Can I try for something else? It's all relational.
It's very bartering kind of.
He wants you to barter with him, but on his terms, because he wants to do something, not because you want to. What's coming out at the end of it is what he desires and his will. So he'll get you to ask for what he wants to do. Moses is an example. He backed him into a corner and till Moses said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. So he said, I'll hide you in the cleft of the rock. Why did Moses ask that? Because God had got him backed up into a corner to ask for what God wanted to give him. So he backs you up into a corner till you ask for what he wants to give you, and then he delights to give it to you. That's the way he works. It's knowing his ways.
And a mystic will know his ways,
will learn his ways. You know, blessed is the man who says he knows me, it says in the Old Testament. Let him boast in this, that he knows and understands me. We need to know the ways of God, not just the works of God. The Israelites knew the works of God, and look where it got them. Moses knew his ways.